郑重但是咸
阿
康
弥陀
地
佛，
啊啊，诸位长辈啊，诸位同修，大家晚上吉祥啊，阿弥陀佛。
阿弥陀佛，
Uncle James, the president of NSW, Amitabha Associations, and fellow brothers and sisters of Dharma, good evening.
今天很高兴又跟我们雪梨的同学们老中青三代应该都有大家又聚在线上，这个也很感谢时间也很快我们相见的到现在又
两个月了，
经过2个多月了。
对呀，是，
哎，当时候感谢大家，方方面面的照顾。
It's been 2 months since we last met. I'm very, very, very happy to see each other again, to see our, Sydney Dharma brothers and sisters. And time has passed. It's been 2 months, and now we're here, having this session.
今天。这个迪伦样子很专业好像播音员一样。
我买下来了。This is, but remember, say I look professional because of the microphone.
很专业这个老祖宗说"工欲善其事，必先利其器"我们先感谢他这么用心
师傅，谬赞谬赞。So thank you, Venerable, for giving me encouragement to continue to do the best of my job as translator. 阿弥陀佛。
上次到雪梨跟大家有一起学习的机会对于我们很多长辈们他们闻到佛法的都非常珍惜。非常认真用功，而且跟随我们正总贤康利还有道场长期几十年学习这个都是非常难得的因缘所以相信我们坚持下去呢，可以同生极乐国当然老中青三代都是那对于。上一次去有2次机会跟我们这些青年团的年轻朋友们大家有交流的机会陈德也是很欢喜因为一个家也好，一个团体也好都要靠我年轻人。来乘船，来接棒，看到这么多年轻人都学佛，而且也很积极，在深入，也希望把佛法，能够用在他的生活、工作、处事待人接物当中，所以，这是。在佛菩萨的加持下，我们有因缘大家一起探讨佛法，所以这个现在回来2个多月有点想念大家所以跟大家再见见面互相学习，
是我们想念你啊！
好，谢谢，谢谢。
阿弥陀佛，谢谢师父。So today, we have people of all, age group, coming together, gathering together, to listen, to share about the Dharma. It's to thank Uncle and Uncle James and Auntie Cynthia and everyone in the Amitabha New South Wales, for all their effort, you know, their blood, sweat, and tears all these years. They pour into this association so that everyone can have this environment. I believe that no matter what stage are we in our life, we all have a stronger and we'll get stronger and get better in our vow to be born in Pure Land. That is a certainty. So young people is very important in propagation of the Buddha Dharma. We do rely on our next generations to pass on these wisdoms. And these wisdoms of the Buddha can be used not just in temple, but it can be used in our daily life, in our work. And this won't happen without the blessings from the Buddha and Bodhisattvas, without the protections, without the convenience that given by them, whether we can see or not. So it's been 2 months since I met you all in Sydney, and I do honestly miss you all. That's why I would like to borrow this chance, take this opportunity to gather with everyone again. So Uncle James say, we miss you too as well. I believe he spoke on our behalf very truthfully. Thank you.
那这个大家方便的话呢，都可以打开镜头啊，这见面三分情啊，大家不要害羞啊。
Please feel free to open your camera because you know, able to see each other in eye to eye.Face to face is more, how to say, it helps for us to exchange our heart easily, our thoughts and our hearts.
好，我们这个学佛过程啊，偶一大师有说，善有为依呀，啊，依众靠众，啊，所以我们有这个一段时间啊，大家在线上。啊，可以就啊，我们啊，在生活、工作、处事、待人接物当中啊，实际也我们遇到的问题啊，还有我们怎么用佛法来解决，大家可以探讨啊。这个就像啊，老祖宗说的，要如切如磋，如琢如磨啊，大家一起切磋琢磨啊，可能。透过大家的切磋的集思广益的啊，对一件事情呢看得更深啊，看得更全面哦，那我们一起相聚就大家就增广见闻了啊，这个见识远见都透过大家的探讨能够有所提升了。所以佛法是觉悟之法啊，觉悟了任何事情都能解决啊，都能往好的地方发展啊，这个是我们首先呢要有的信心啊。好，
阿弥陀佛，谢谢师父。So, Venerable Master Oyi, has a teaching that can be used in daily life, and we can use this, teachings of Buddhism to solve our daily problems. Every issues, like what we do right here, can be discussed in group, because if we put it out there in a group, everyone has a different experience, ideas, perspectives. And sometimes if we put it out there in the open and allowing everyone to talk about it, discuss about it, you will often see, you know, either the people find a different spot that you might not discover if you're on your own. Sometimes the clash of ideas might give birth to a new solutions, to a new pathways, to the new ways of thinking, to the new ways of, moving forward. It helps to improve ourselves. Remember, Buddhism is all about awakening. And awaken, once we awaken, every problem we met will have a solution. Nothing is insurmountable.阿弥陀佛。
好，那看大家有没有要提出来的问题。
Question time, guys.
或者你最近学习的 法喜喜悦，也可以跟大家分享。
Or the joys, or the afterthoughts, or the reflection of what you have experienced recently. Doesn't have to be question, it can be sharing what you have experienced recently.
这也算法布施啊，法布施得聪明智慧。
If you share it out there, you are giving the Dharma to everyone, and the giving of Dharma means the gaining intelligence.啊，我就抛砖引玉啊，师傅，没人开始我就来了。好，I'll start. Hopefully, we can bring out more ideas. 师傅好，阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛，
感恩啊，首先感恩您啊，能在这边百忙中为我们开讲啊。那迪伦也不是问题，也是感想啊，就是刚刚旅游了三个星期啊，总觉得。奔波奔来奔去，虽然很漂亮，风景很好，但是总觉得心里面永远没有底，永远是浮躁的。这次旅游呢，感觉就是说，不管你跑到多远啊，天涯海角，一个人啊，如果没有一个怎么讲，主心主轴，他的人生中间没有一个主干了、啊，他都是会永远感觉不到快乐。不到满足，不管风景有多漂亮，人事物有多美好，心里面如果是漂浮不定的，永远都会很浮躁。好的事情也会变得不那么好，坏的事情会变本加厉。当然也有冷静的时候，但是就觉得这样奔波一次，就会觉得很累，觉得这个人生有时候就是我们忙来忙去，到底忙到什么时候？就算玩也会觉得很忙，所以什么时候才能定下来？那怎样才可以说在这种动来动去的社会里面，这个比较动荡的社会，或者是比较动荡的生活方式能找到一个定心丸？谢谢师父。
好，这个。迪伦呢？他出去旅游哈、三个星期，他的心得他觉得心还不是很安啊、那当然，我们听到这里也是要问问我们自己的心啊。安不安？到底我们比方说我们出去玩的目的是什么？或者我们人生，我们每一天都在努力呀、工作的时间也蛮长的了，到底我们的目标是什么？目的是什么？这可能我们要很清楚假如我们每天很努力，但都不知道目标在哪里，那这个心也会比较茫然的。这个中国字啊，挺有味道的啊。这个茫然的茫啊。有好几个写法这个忙字第一个是忙，很忙了左边一个星呢，右边一个王忙的不知道为什么就好像星死了忙再来你太忙，忙到每天一天过一天，怎么一个月又过去了，一年又过去了，很茫然到底我这么忙有没有意义啊？这个第二个忙茫茫人海那个忙最后忙到最后看不清楚人生了 意义何在的，最后就眼盲的盲了。那我们都知道人生难得啊，佛法难闻啊。假如最后忙到最后都不知道在忙什么，这个就很可惜了。所以像喜欢旅游的人，他一定是希望借由旅游找到快乐啊。所以这个快乐啊，应该是人所追求的。都希望幸福快乐啊。但我们一般要找快乐呢，都是向外找。好像外面会给我们快乐。孔子在《论语》里面呢，讲的第一句话呢，学而时习之，不亦说乎？他不是从外面呢，他是学了之后啊，学了之后，实习之呢，那个习是去例行了，他会快乐喜悦，他那种喜悦呀，是从内而外出来的。举个例子啊。比方说他今天了解到老法师说的念念为他人着想，这个道理他懂了他去做了，他从今天开始的替人家着想了，做着做着，他内心有喜悦的，他体会到助人为乐了，助人快乐这个不是别人给我的，是我做的过程啊，我自己内心里面出来了，所以真正的乐它是从内而外出来的。但是我们都误会呢，这个快乐是要从外面来，从外面来叫刺激，然后刺激一下持续不了太久啊，所以刚刚迪伦有说好事也不是那么好啊。就好像刺激一下，好像觉得哎呀挺好，但是呢，这个内心还是空虚，不是很安。讲的有点长了，迪伦你翻一下。
谢谢师傅，我就从问题，然后再翻到师傅的答案，一起啊。Just now I ask, I went for two-three weeks travel in overseas.I say that it's beautiful sceneries, but sometimes all this, you know, hustle and bustle, rushing off one after another locations would make me felt that everything is too a bit pointless sometimes. Like it's beautiful, but just for one moment. But after that, I felt empty. I felt lost. I felt like sometimes, you know, I don't.Like it's not what you expected, or you know, you feel tired. All these sensations coming in. So I'm asking this, and then I extrapolate into sometimes in our life, you know, we're busy traveling, busy working, busy taking care of families, etc., etc. At the end of all this, you know, what's the point of it?You know, like after one event after another event, never ending trains of stuff to do. But, you know, but we like beneath this current, what is the point? You know, what is the point where we can settle down, where we actually find our anchor? And Venerable answered that first thing we need to ask ourselves, is our heart settled?Is our heart at peace? Settle in a way, is our heart at peace? Say, if you're going to travel or going to work, what are the goals you're doing that, right? There must be a need for something for you to do these activities. These activities also is time taking a lot of time in our lives. You know, like travel, it takes weeks. You go to work 8 hours at least every day. Venerable has bring out three Chinese words which I just pop up in chats to drive the point home of, you know, what busyness really means, really is. First thing, Chinese word 忙, as you can see in the top, is combination of heart and death. That means your heart is dead. Basically, you felt fatigue or you felt pointless because you keep busy, like you start working and you don't have time for, you know, turning the attention inwards. So your heart is dead. Number two is you felt lost because you're not pointing the attention inwards. You felt lost. The second Chinese word refers to lost. First one is busy. Second is lost. 忙. They are all the same Chinese pronunciation, but different meanings. If you look at the third one, in the end, very end, we felt lost to a point where we cannot see our self anymore, our life anymore. Where are we going with this? 忙, like, which is blind. So first one is busy, second one is lost, third one is blind. Our eyes, we cannot see where are we going anymore. It's so now we need to go back to ourselves, our life. It's very hard to be a human, and it's even harder to be a human who heard Buddhism. So it gets harder and harder as we get there. And at this rare opportunity of being a Buddhist human, human who are Buddhist, who listen to Dharma, it gets us to think like what really matters. And so going back to my question, if people like to travel, it's because they found joy in traveling. And joy, happiness is the pursuit, default pursuit of every humankind, no matter where you came from, what your background is. Happiness is something that we all pursue after, you know. But what kind of happiness is that, right? We still need to be busy in our daily business, but it should be something that makes us happy, even though it's very busy, not something that makes us blind, busy, and lost. So busy but happy, but busy with a sense of purpose, busy with a sense of joy. And Confucius has said a very beautiful word. When you learn something and you put it in practice, your joy just come out, flush out, rush out from inside. So the joy of applying what you learn in daily life comes from the inside. So this very famous word from Confucius, analect, says that our joy is found from the inside by pointing inwards. For example, Master Ching Kong say, care about others all the time. Always, 念念为大家着想, always think about others all the time. From the beginning, might feel reluctant, but as you get deeper and deeper into this practice, all right, and put action to this teachings of caring about others, the joy comes out. You're just simply being happy by looking at others being happy. And you can be busy, very busy taking care of them, but you're very happy while doing it. That's why we are busy. That's what we should be busy for. But Venerable Chanda has emphasized, if the joy we found from outside, it's called excitement, 刺激, excitement, like pleasure, essentially pleasure. It's not long-lasting, like beautiful scenery, beautiful moment, but it's not, it cannot be sustained. And a Venerable stop here because give me the space to translate. So,
当然迪伦啊，他刚刚提到啊，他出去旅游啊，但是还是感觉心不是很安啊。那这样的一个体会啊，观察，自我的观察，这个就已经是很有善根了。一般的人呢，他假如说出去旅游，感觉好像这个快乐还不是很能保持他就可能要跑更多的地方到更多地方去旅游去 shopping 他可能是用这样的方法来解决。 就是可能让那个刺激啊更强烈，看能不能真正的心安，看能不能有一个长远的快乐。一般人看事情啊，没有办法看得那么深，看得那么根本。但迪伦他完了之后，他是看他的根本，他的心是不是真正安定了很幸福了他有观察到这里，所以因为他觉得他心不安，所以他会去找方法来安心一般的人还不见得会思考这个问题
阿弥陀佛，谢谢师父。So, like when we travel, our heart, first thing, thank you, Venerable, for being very kind in his words. And then, now back to the point, heart is not at peace. That's the one of the conclusions I found after I traveled. So this is something that warrants give rise to two kind of reaction. Number one is finding the cause. Why am I not at peace? Even though I've been to many good places and good people. Second one is because I'm not satisfied with the joy, I seek to shop more places to play to enhance the sensory enjoyment. So Venerable say that, we can learn to be more introspective in our thoughts and our experiences, rather than seeking the outer pleasures, seeking to enhance or add more a point of pleasure into our externally. Because asking the right question is the beginning of, finding the right solution, getting to the root of all of it. If we only dwell on the surface, say, I don't think I shop enough, I don't think I play enough, I need to go more places, I need to travel more places to be more happy, then we will never be satisfied. We'll never reach that point where we're content, at peace. We're always seeking more and more and more and more. So it's very important to find out the right questions and pursuit solution in the right direction. In this case, find a way to put ourselves at peace, our heart at peace, no matter what we do. 阿弥陀佛。师父有很多有些问题啊，师父您还要敌人会讲吗？还是？
对，是有人问问题的是吧？
有两位。
哦，好，那个。这个我们刚刚提到，比方说 shopping 啊，就是说我们想从外面呢、找到快乐啊，来解决问题嘛啊。那大家有没有遇过啊？哪一个人啊？他有痛苦了啊，然后他去 shopping 啊，最后他呢啊，就从此就很安乐了啊，都没有再有痛苦了啊。很可能呢，他得越买越多，因为刺激嘛，强度要越来越大啊。然后，但是呢，好像问题还是没有解决，所以这个要从外面来解决问题啊，透过刺激来解决问题，得到新的安乐，这不大可能的了。对，所以佛法就是教我们安心的方法了。
Speaking of shopping, instead of say if we're discontent, this is one of the sufferings we have, is discontentment or greed, and we might fall in the trap of getting more shoppings to fulfill in that gap, the void that can never be filled, or any other sort of entertainment. It's very important for us to find a solution to to actually get to the bottom of this issues, rather than covering our eyes and blindly pursuit pleasure, because we'll never be able to solve the problem without getting to the root. Buddhism is always about getting to the root of the problem. and then eventually solve it. 阿弥陀佛。
这个心要安啊，就大家有没有啊？比方说小时候的感觉啊，好像啊，在外面遇到什么事情啊，进了这个家的门呢、啊，好像心很安了。这个爸爸妈妈哈、兄弟姐妹啊，都会一起支持我把这个事情啊解决掉。啊，没有解决不了的问题，好像天塌下来都有爸爸妈妈扛着，所以这个家让人很安心呢、啊。哦，所以我们现在要到哪一个家去呢？才能什么问题都解决了，心才能够安呢、啊？这个是我们要思考的问题了，以什么为归宿了？才能真正解决问题呢、哦、所以释迦牟尼佛都劝我们要求生西方极乐世界、啊、那个才是脱离了轮回了，因为没有出去轮回啊，问题没解决了、啊、我们还是要一直轮回，一直受苦了，这个心还是安不了、哦、所以我们往生了痛苦就解决了，而且啊，现在呢，心能安在阿弥陀佛佛号上啊，问题也能解决。啊，你安在佛号上，你的心就会越来越安定。啊，而且你念佛的时候啊，阿弥陀佛会加持你啊。啊，加持你呢，你就业障会消啊，过灭善生呢。身意柔软，身心都会越来越好、哦、然后越来越定了、哦、而且心越来越清净了、啊、清净心呢、啊、生智慧，你好好念佛，心安在佛号，不烦恼，心越来越清净了，你遇到事情啊，你就知道怎么去处理了、哦、所以念佛除了让我们这一生能往生极乐世界之外，其实当下就能帮助我们很大，帮助我们心安下来，不要胡思乱想，帮助我们心清净了，有智慧去处理事情。所以今天讲安心哈，要安在阿弥陀佛上面哈。
阿弥陀佛，感恩师父。In the you know, daily life, and when sometimes we meet problems with our relationships or any other worldly matters, jobs, financials, etc., we find, you know, going back to our parents' home, you know, going back to that familiar routine, familiar people, familiar smell, food, puts us at ease. You know, going home, basically, puts us at ease. That home that our heart belongs to, puts us at ease.So does our, you know, cultivation in Buddhism. Like, in our real life, you know, where do we actually return to solve all these sufferings, these issues? Six rims never stopped moving. It keeps recreating these problems and again and again and again. It keeps going. There is no ending to this. So the way we can get out of it is to go to a home where we can, you know, like,we go into our parents' house or the house that we call home, a place we call home, to shelter from all this or to get away from all these troubles. In our way, we use Amitofo. If our heart is set on Amitofo, to be honest, we can solve all the problems. Why? Because mindfulness on Amitofo has many benefits. First thing, Amitofo already has the vow in his 48 vows to give us to bless us with what we need in daily life, with what we exactly need in our daily life, and also the mentally, spiritually, it puts us at ease. If our heart is settled, everything is clear, because a settled heart will clarify our mind, the thoughts and everything. And a clear mind will help us to give rise to wisdoms. because we can see things clearly, we can find the root of the problem, we can go step one, step two, step three, naturally. So we need to start settle our heart on Amitabha, and that will help us to produce more, how to say, clarity, because we don't move around frantically anymore, and hence we have more wisdom to overcome all the problems that are thrown at us in this world. Hence, it's very important to have a pure heart, a heart that is clear, pure. Yeah, that's it. That's my note.
好，Dylan 好像有几个问题哈，那可以有英文的，再麻烦你。
好，
翻一下。
好的，师傅。So I'll start moving on to another question. So Dimple Week, our guest, has said that as a leader in the workplace, how do you know when to take a soft versus strict approach with staff to influence them? If a staff member is rude to others, how to protect others by controlling this behavior whilst not being controlling? So 师傅，这一位同修他问啊，身为一个单位的领导，你如何知道这是我们应该身为领导应该什么应该怎样拿捏这个分寸，就是管理的分寸，就是什么时候应该严格，什么时候应该比较柔和一点，是什么时候应该严，什么时候应该柔因为他面对的这些员工啊，有些员工非常的无理，对人家比较粗鲁，讲话粗鲁还是态度粗鲁。那身为领导者啊，他要如何保护这一些员工不受其他这些比较不听话的员工影响呢？那他又担心会变得太多控，变成一个控制狂，所以要怎么样拿捏这个分寸？管理之道了，他问对。
好，
阿弥陀佛。
我们现在呀、处理事情了、首先有一个心理的一个准备哈、就是我们面对的问题啊，都是冰冻三尺非一日之寒的、所以。我们都要有耐性啊去处理它。因为像这些员工他走到我们生命来了，他都已经是大人了。所以等于是说这个我们体会到啊，这个社会呢这种伦理道德因果教育啊长期比较缺乏了。那这样我们对这个社会的一种包容的心呢就会比较提得起来。这是第一个角度吧，就是我们现在什么事情啊冰冻三尺非一日之寒，要有耐性去处理它。那这个我们要管理别人呢，那可能首先呢、我们先管理好自己的情绪了。因为我假如控制不了情绪了，那我去管对方啊，可能对方就只觉得我脾大。他可能不知道我用心啊是为了护念他改正这个错误的行为。所以我们面对员工跟我们面对小孩其实都是一样的，就是面对一个境缘。当我们首先是有情绪的时候，可能对方的印象就是我们的情绪。哪怕我们讲的话是很有道理的，可能他落的印象就是情绪。所以要掌握情绪啊才能掌握未来。所以我们哪怕是管理的人，我们要练的不能动气。但他的行为很不好啊，要怜悯他， 悯人之胸啊，因为他这些行为造的都是三恶业，他那个业种下去了，他一定要到三恶道去报道了。哇，那到三恶道，那不是开玩笑的，下去啊，很久才能出来了。啊，所以我们会很生气的人，你换另外一个角度，他是很可怜的人。他得了人生这么尊贵的人生，他还在造这些恶业。所以我们是出发点是为了他好，去管他，去护念他的。那护念人呢？孔子说因材施教啊。那这个人很恶劣了，那当然你就要用规范呢，公司的规范呢，甚至比较严肃。你不够严肃呢，他都好像不当回事。那这个时候你得要严肃跟他讲了。那眼睛看着他炯炯有神啊，很有威严。然后心里念阿弥陀佛。但不要动气。就是很威严的劝导他，然后为他好，劝导他的过程，利害关系啊，跟他说明白，这样做对你自己很不好，就是哪怕我们是去指正他，我们就是那种言语的表达，也让对方觉得我们是为他好的，虽然我们的言语是严肃的，而说实实在在的，我们确实也是为他好。因为我们不是发脾气，我们也没有跟他对立啊。我曾经，我们呢带一个班六年级男同学呀，很调皮呀，但是我劝他的时候啊，我是真正为他好。所以我劝他，我自己都流眼泪了，被我自己感动了。所以公司是有公司的规定的，所以规定是要讲原则，这个要面对这个不守规矩的人还是要严格。那他不对的时候你要严格。他有表现好的你也赞叹他。让他感觉这领导不是对我有看法。他是对事不对人。我有一点不错了，他还是肯定我的。就是一个原则吧。那当然，员工刚进来的时候啊，我们带的原则还是先严后宽。你假如一开始宽了，后来要严就不好严了。就好像我们在学校带班，一开始要建立规矩。你不能班级来了，哇，他们都很散漫了，到时候你一严格了，他就跟你结怨了。你一开始来，他还比较谨慎的态度，战战兢兢。你讲规矩，让他守规矩了，慢慢可以，大家守规矩了，可以放宽一点，他就会觉得，哎呀，这领导真慈祥，这个先严后宽。好，
感恩师父。So we start with the response of Venerable towards the first question. If we recall that the Tongxiu, the Dharma sister brother, is a leader in workplace, would like to know what is the best way to manage a difficult staff while not being too much, too controlling, too overbearing. So basically, how do we manage others and ourselves? So first thing, Venerable said, Rome is not built in one day. In the direct translation would be the formation of the iceberg is not done within 3 days. That means to be an iceberg, it takes a long, long time of accumulation. So facing these kind of problems, we need to have patience. First thing, we need to be very patient because it cannot be solved immediately. So that staff is already an adult, right? That means they know the rules, right? If we face this situation of people being rude to another, being very, overbearing, not considerate, being, unwholesome towards other people, then we are witnessing a consequences of lacking kindness, the teaching of kindness, teaching of morality, teaching of love, a humanity teaching. It's very lacking in our society. You are witnessing this reality before your eyes. So in face of these facts, in face of these realities in our society, we need to be patient. We need to understand it cannot be solved immediately. You can't just whip them back to shape. It's not how it works. Because this kind of negligence does not happen in one day. It's a long overdue generational process of negligence in teaching this morality, decencies, being kind to other people, putting others before yourself. This thing has been neglected for many generations and leading cause and effect, leading to this kind of outcome. First priority. So in face of this, our first thought would be emotion. What is our emotion? What kind of emotion are we in? All right. If we cannot manage our emotions, we cannot get our point across to them. We cannot get our point to their heart, to their ears, to their mind, because it was overwhelmed with our emotions, our temper. Yes, we really want to help them. We really want to protect the staff that was being bullied. But if we already started with being angry, flaring the temper, then we already lose the first step. We already lose the first game. So it's actually quite similar to managing children, according to Venerable. Their impressions of you, starts because they register your emotion first, faster than they register your actual point. They register the reaction that you have, the anger, the face, the tone, before they actually listen to what you want to say. That's why we need to start with our emotions. People who get angry easily actually is the one who had it worst in their life. We should be more sympathetic towards them. So those people who are hard to manage usually are people who, have the issues with their emotions, temper flaring, right? Or they can't control themselves and hence lashing out on other people, doing something untowards others. So these people are the one that should be sympathized, should be understood as sad, rather than just being angry towards them. Why? Because every action has a reaction. Every cause has an effect. Karma is always there, no matter what you do. And this person, people who do this, do things that are untowards to others, things that are bad towards others, will get it manifold in future. So their future is bleak, painful, suffering, and more pain. And that is very sad, really, if you see the consequences firsthand. Because getting a human is very, very fortunate. Being a human is very fortunate. Being called a human, being a human, standing up as a human is such an elegant, such a honorable, such a fortunate thing. Like you and I standing here as human. I have to emphasize this. It's very, very, very fortunate. So using this human body to do this kind of non-human things, or rather peaceful things, or things that are not a proper human should be doing, is sad, is tainting it, is wasting that potential. it's such a painful thing to see. So if we need to carry a point across, so step one, emotions, and Venerable continues with step two. If we need to carry point across, we need to be firm in our stares and tone when addressing the issues. So we need to be firm. We need to be, as you say, strict approach to get the point across. But we cannot cross the threshold of being angry and lash out. That means you can be firm, you can be stern, but you cannot be angry. Outside, the performance is firm, all right? But inside, it's always Amitofo. And carrying the word Amitofo means compassion. It means inside, you're always chanting Amitofo, Amitofo, or thinking, it is the same thing. It's thinking, I want to benefit them. I want to protect them. I want to assist them from falling out of the society. And in future, I want to help them, push them. I mean, how to say, pull them from the edge of suffering, right? Compassion, helping them. So that's what we should be doing, right? So first, manage emotion. Second is be firm in your point, addressing it. You need to be strict, but inside you cannot be angry. Instead, you should be sympathetic, should be loving, should be like caring after your children. So when Venerable was a teacher, he taught a classroom of Liu Nianji, year six, he used kindness. He used that kind of mindset, you know, what he taught us in addressing the children's behavioral problems until he cried himself as well. So students and him both cried at the end. So that's how we should manage. In an organization, there's always rules and principles. Otherwise, it will be chaotic. If the behavior is wrong, cross the line, it has to be addressed firmly, staunch, firmly. It has to be addressed in principle. So you have to be firm about holding the rules upright. If they do something good, reward them accordingly. The order of management is very important, however, because if we start being loose and happy with them, like very easy on them, and then you get strict after that, they will be harbor grudges against you. You always need to start being firm. I took a liberty of saying like a drill sergeant walking into this army room, they're being straight ahead. Lay down the rules, lay down the law before applying, you know, relaxation slowly. And that's how it should be done. Start by being strict and firm on principle and rules, then slowly relax as you go, according to the context. And that's how you successfully manage yourself and an organization. Amitofo.
This佛门有说，尤其李炳南老师有说，困难越大。功德越大，欢迎困难，欢迎困难，就是我们现在可能面对的境界都不轻松但是呢，不吃亏，你现在面对比方说你管理团体啊，考验很多，这个困难越大，功德越大，所以。这个没有天底下没有吃亏也没有占便宜的事情啊，所以假如你现在面对这个考试比较厉害啊，给自己幽默一下，老天也很瞧得起我啊，所以考的这个试题比较不简单，那处在管理的位置啊，甚至于是扮演好每一个我们人生的角色啊。尽好我们的本分了，老和尚有三个字心法，就是做之君，做之亲，做之师，就是我们都以这个君亲师啊来自我要求我的心念呢，我的行为要跟君亲师相应， 那我的心跟行就是正确的。我所处理的任何问题就是往好的方向在发展的。好，但是我们的心念言行假如没有跟君亲师相应了，那可能事情就不能往好的方向发展了。因为我们所处理的事啊，佛家叫依报，随着正报转，正报是我的心，我的心用对了，这事往好的方向发展，我的心用不对了，它就往不好的方向发展。好，那这三个字啊，就是调我们的心呢。好，首先君，君要以身作则啊。我们不能常去要求别人，没有自己先带头的话，那我们管的人他不服气的。所以这个君要以身作则，君要大公无私。我们都是为公为大局，我没有偏心。一个领导者一偏心了，底下的人就可能心就不服了，不平了。所以这个君的精神，以身作则，大公无私，还要知人善任，你要用对人，比方说你现在用一个人去管理事情，结果这个人德行不好，然后又偷懒，又不是身先士卒，又不是自己带头去做，然后都是叫别人干，自己都不干，哇！那你用这样的人，底下的人都不服气了，所以这个军里面还要知人善任，你把人用对了，哇！你团体人说：“哎呀，用得好啊，对你很佩服。”你用错人了，他们很不认可。很有意见的。再来，我们虽然是领导啊，可是我们还在修行，我们还不是圣人，所以当有人提醒我们的不对的时候，我们能接受，是吧？纳谏，接受别人的劝谏。那当我们能接受别人劝的时候啊，底下的人也会对我们比较佩服。所以当领导人也不能好面子，错了不承认了，那底下人也会不认可。这个是做之君。再来做之亲。这个亲就是我有没有把同仁当亲人一样来爱护他。你把他们当亲人，这个向心力就会强。再来做之师。你看老师会引导下属。尤其他犯错的时候，你可以抓住这个机会点呢，引导他。他汲取教训呢，他人生就有所成长了。或者他表现得很可贵很好的，你肯定他称赞如来，也是普贤行嘛。你的肯定或者你的规劝，你肯定他的善不断增长，你规劝他的恶不断改正，那你就是他生命的老师了。这是做之师。你随时以这君亲师来，我做的够不够君亲师的精神，我们就会察觉，我还有很多可以努力的部分。那你越努力，员工应该跟你的关系就越来越好。因为依报嘛，随着我们的心，随着我们的正报转的。好，
阿弥陀佛，感恩师父。So, first, when Master Ching Kong's teacher, Master Li Bingnan, has said a very interesting word, that the bigger the hurdle, the bigger the achievements. So welcome, dear trouble, welcome, dear trouble, said Master Li Bingnan. To be honest, you won't be taken advantage in the end as long as you persist in this journey of this struggle, you know, to find a way out, to solve it. So in this struggle of, you know, managing a workplace, there are three principles, you know, being a leader. There are three principles we should heed from Master Ching Kong. Because able to achieve, use these three principles in our, you know, conduct as a leader, will make this organization run smoothly. First one is be a leader figure. Be a leader figure means, we'll explain later. And then second one is to be a parental figure. The third one is to be a mentor figure. So a leader, parental figure, and mentor figure. If we put ourselves in these three mindsets for managing an organization, only then the organization could be ran properly. If, however, we deviate from these three principles, we would lose our way. And the consequences is your failure in managing a group. First principle, to be a leader means to be a role model. We need to be fair. We need to be fair and square in everything we will manage in this group. No one-sided, you know, no preference one other over another. Everything is out and open. No prejudice. That's number third. And then be a leader also means appoint right person to a right position. Delegate properly. Delegate a right person to a right role. For example, the consequences of not doing so, if you appoint someone with questionable conduct to manage people, say they're ordering people around while they're just, you know, sitting there pretending to be working, lazy around, of course no one will listen to them in long run. You know, they will just turn up just to get the money. They will not properly, you know, put their hearts and soul into the work. And even if we are a leader, we are still cultivating. We are still normal people. We are not a sage. So we should be always opened to suggestions, open to advice. We should not try to protect our face and refuse counsel. Counsel is very important as a leader. Only then people will feel like this person can be discussed, can be talked to. So they will be more willing to work for the organization that you manage. Second principle is to be a parental figure. Parents, you know, means it came from a place of love. It warms the hearts, warms the cockles, it warms the hearts, and makes everyone wants to push another 100% above their 100% to contribute to the group. That means this group has a center, has a core. Instead of everyone just turn up, everyone really wants to contribute because they love each other, like their family. Number three is to be a mentor, a teacher. Help them to be better at their task. If they do well, praise and encourage them. If they struggle, assist them to get out of this struggle by teaching them the methods. And always, you know, coming from a place of nurturing, from a place of growing, and only then we will have a more complete merits in our conduct. So understand these three principles will make us a very, very, very good leader. Thank you. Amitabha. Sifu, 我要问下一个问题吗? 对不起,师父, 您静音了。
Amitabha, 师父, 延续这个问题哦, 假如说你底下的员工 不是你interview进来的, 是上头指派来的, 他会有这种想法, 我又不是你找来, 是上头派过来的, 他那种态度不服你, 那这样的员工 我们怎么去处理? 因为是上头派过来的,
他上层派过来的, 他毕竟已经归到这个组织里面来了。 所以 我们做我们该做的嘛。那他说上面派过来，那他也要做好啊，这样才对得起上面的人信任他，把他派过来啊。我们现在所有的考虑都是为了单位好啊，我们是秉公，为公啊，为整体在考虑啊。哎呀，一码归一码，这个不能混在一起啊。哦，首先他上面派的，上面对他有知遇之恩，哦，但上面派他过来干嘛？不希望他发展得更好吗？啊，不然希望他干嘛？哎，哦，比方说他是上面派过来，他的心态有什么不妥吗？好，那我们了解他心态的不妥，我们去跟他沟通的时候，也不是指责他，我们是真的为他好。当他心态有不妥的时候，其实对他不利的。哦，我们怎么用他能接受的方法提醒到他？哎，那这个就很重要了。哦，那他不接受呢？他不接受也不影响我们的功德，因为我们的心用对就好了。岂能尽如人意嘛？但求无愧我心呢？我该怎么顾念他？我尽到力了。他不能接受，那是有他的善根福德因缘，这个我也不能强求。哎，这个我们处事也是，岂能尽如人意啊？但求无愧我心去做就好了。哎，
阿弥陀佛，师父要继续吗？还是我可以继续答？
可以了，可以。
OK， 好。So if Uncle James asked, if the stuff is sent from higher management, that means it was being put into our unit instead of going through the selection. How do we manage these people? Maybe they have a problematic attitudes, context. So since it's already been sent from higher up, Venerable answered, since it has been sent from higher up, it's a part of the organization. The unit of our thoughts should always be based on the betterment of whole organization instead of just personal histories. It should be like, can he benefit the organization? I might not like him, but can he benefit this group or not? The point of them coming to our unit, maybe the point of higher up sending this person to our unit is maybe try to grow this person, you know, to groom this person into a person suitable for the role they might be taking. So our task should be trying to remind this person if they have problem in their attitude to correct it. Our task should always be finding a way they can accept. Finding people they can accept and then listen to the advice and trying to, you know, correct or trying to adjust their attitude, their behavior, their conduct so that they are productive to this unit. If they don't accept our advice, we did our best, man. Like, there's no perfect life in this world. There's nothing called perfection in this world. There's nothing called everything go according to your will. Life will always sometimes go against your way. We just can't have everything in our way. So as long as we did not do wrong by them, we did our best. That's what it matters. That's all that counts. We did not do wrong by them, by the organization. Whether that person can take it or not is his own issues. That means his ability to accept advice, his ability to be a reflective person. That's up to them. So we did our part. Take it or not, it's up to them.
这个在现在这个时代啊，别人对不对啊，不是最重要，我们自己先做对了。哦，因为别人他不一定有学到伦理道德因果宗教教育了。哦，那我们有学到了，就从我们开始做起了。我们心用对了，对方接受不跟不追受，我们都是功德圆满。所以 我们把自己的心守好就对了。那这个管理方面哈，刚好呢，三月份我们有三天呢，就是晋中的干部，马来西亚干部啊，我们一起聚，就是谈怎么管理团队。啊，那有录音，到时候我请郑总啊再发给大家，大家可以做参考啊。因为管理真的是一门学问哈，我们从里面也找到一些啊，像李炳南老师的指导啊，啊老和尚的指导啊，佛法的指导，看看怎么来透过佛门的智慧啊，传统化的智慧来扮演好这个领导的角色，跟大家一起交流。
阿弥陀佛。So we are, whether other is correct in this modern era, whether other's conduct is correct is secondary. What is the most important is we need to have a right conduct ourselves. We need to be doing the right thing ourselves. If what we do coming out from a right place in our heart, it's good enough. We cannot factor in whether they will accept or not, whether they will act according to us or not. That's up to them. So speaking of management, so change the topic, Venerable say we already talk about management in Malaysia. Venerable already talk about management in Malaysia forum. It has been done in March this year. It has been recorded. So Venerable will pass on to Uncle James, because inside this forum, there are many wisdoms of Master Ching Kong, wisdoms of many teachers, of their management, in management, because this is a very important thing to talk about. 阿弥陀佛。
好，我们看第二个问题啊，他，你要不要用英文翻译一下？
可以，我先中后英哦。阿弥陀佛师父，这位是 WNMUMY， 我不会读。怎么教育孩子在学校为了正义做正些事情，但又不伤害到自己呢？跳博，
好，
听不懂，因为我翻不了。How do we educate the children at school？
又不会伤害到自己呢？就是做正嘛。为了正义做正
些事情，
但是他怕做正了以后呢，可能会这些犯错的同学来报复他，怕他受伤害了。
就是好像一个，好像说他目睹了一个人欺负另外一个，然后去跑出来作证，
但
是又怕被伤害。
对呀，
Do we educate our children at school? You know, like say sometimes they might witness bullying in school, for example, and to be a witness. I think you guys might see on the TV, witness protection program. Anyway, so how do we become, how do we educate the children in school to protect themselves? So like they want, because of justice, they want to go out and point out this kid's bully the other kids. However, how do they protect themselves while doing that? Means how do they not painting a target behind their backs while still doing something that is right, you know, that's just 阿弥陀佛。
好，这个世界啊比较乱了，所以我们现在遇到很多不懂伦理道德啊、因果这些行为啊，首先呢，就是我们怜悯这些做错的人再来也警觉啊，这个世界乱了，不能留恋李炳南老师说，这个世界乱了，现在唯一一条生路啊，念佛求生净土啊。无量寿经也提醒我们，五恶五痛五烧酒后转聚啊。所以现在这些现象呢，也让我们求处理办移民移民到西方极乐世界去那现在这些遇到的这些很 恶劣的行为啊，对我们来讲，也是一个让我们不留恋世间的真上缘。啊，你换个角度都有积极的意义在。那毕竟我们现在还活在这个世间啊，那孔子有教我们，见义不为，无勇也。啊，这个是道义应该做的事，我们不做啊，啊，那没有勇气了。啊，甚至于是，可能你自己心也会啊，觉得好像对不起人了。哦，比方说那个被欺负的人，我们都没有站出来。哦，那他可能被欺负得更惨了。那我们心里也会不安了。哦，我们良心上会不安了。哦，所以我们现在可能都会面临一种两难的状况。哦，那还是要用智慧啊去处理了。好，好，那当然呢，这个孩子到底几岁啊，又是一个问题了。啊，他还小，可能问题比较不大。啊，他假如都已经五六年级了，哇，那个学生有的都很高大了，是吧？哎，好，那可能我们父母啊，也要护念。就是老师蛮关键的，这个老师处理问题啊，不会让问题啊更恶化了。哦，所以假如说老师他知道怎么去处理好这个，啊，比方说有学生犯错了，啊，他能处罚到那个犯错的学生，啊，这个。做正义的人尽量也能保护到他，啊，不要让他有那个报复的啊这个心态啊或者是机会。哦，那这个老师也要会处理哦。哎，那可能变成这个学生自己不能跟老师沟通到这样的一种认知默契的话，那可能家长也要出面。啊，就现在有这个情况。啊，那家长跟老师沟通好，我们都是为了班级好。当然这种做这种事情啊，这个对班级的风气是不好的。啊，那怎么处理不会造成作证的人还要受伤害。然后犯错的人老师也是真正借这个机会去劝导他，啊，让他能改过，哦，那这个事就处理得好的话，就变成啊能够帮助犯错的人改正，啊，然后有正义的人，哎，他也尽了他一份力了。但是说实在的，现在因为刚刚我一开始说冰冻三尺非一日之寒了，啊，现在人没有学，他这个可能行为离做人应该有的这些态度行为比较有一段距离了，你不可能一下子叫他完全转过来。那我们遇到现在的这些社会状况，处理上还是要有智慧去拿捏好，啊，让处理的不会再延伸出其他的冲突问题出来。哎，好，
阿弥陀佛。Venerables, in response to this question of, you know, standing up for justice while protecting yourself, your kid, from retributions. It starts with, the world is in a mess. The world is a mess. That's the fact. Many people do not know that behavior hurt the others. You know, they do not aware enough what they say, what they do, it hurt people. and they were blind to their own conscience. That's because of the negligence, as we mentioned earlier, in educating the next generation about being decent, being caring towards others. Very hard to solve this problem from the root. The first thing is the attitude towards this is we should not attach to this world. We should understand that this world is getting towards a downward spiral. And even though it's quite depressing hearing this kind of analysis, but there is a sliver of hope. There's a, you know, if we change our attitudes in face of this, our mindset, it's actually a positive thing. Because we cannot attach to this messy world, attach to this world that has lost its way of decency and kindness. We have strengthened our vow to change our environment that we live in. That means we want to go to Pure Land even more in face of this. Nothing worth loving, I mean, nothing worth attaching about in this world. So that's one kind of attitude we can look at. However, we still have to live in this world. We still have to survive. We still have to do what we need to do. So there's a saying in Confucius teaching. If we saw something unjust, 见义不为无勇者. So if we saw something unjust and ignore it, our courage is lacking. We are coward, basically. Besides, our conscience will blame us for allowing the kid to be bullied, for allowing perpetrator to get away, and to allow this kid to be continue to be, you know, under this emotional trauma. So it requires wisdom to get a very positive outcome out of this. So in this context, it requires wisdom to know how to protect ourselves or protect our kids while still enabling them to stand up for justice, to point out the perpetrator and receive their appropriate punishments or appropriate education. First is the age range. The younger, so it has many contexts, many scenarios. So one factor we need to think about is how young, how old is the kid, are the kids. Younger, the easier; the older, the harder, basically. You know, they get older, they're more sturdy. Sometimes you can't even, you know, restrain them. They might do something more damaging. Second thing is the parents and teacher. So second factor is the managers, you know, the teachers in class, the parents at home. Parents should be able to, you know, protect, provide assistance to teacher to you know, correct the cultures in the school. So that's what's supposed to happen. So teacher, if depends on the teacher, if and the class, if the teacher is able to hold a rein, control this situation, that means they will be able to first avoid vendetta, avoid this kind of retributions between the kids, and second is to educate the kids what is right and what is wrong. Basically, you know, this is not a right thing, and the kids listen, and also protects the kids from each other as well. It's hard. So that's why reality is right and ideas. However, if the teacher lost control of this, then parents should step in and help, you know, assist by at the side to help the teacher to, you know, to de-escalate the situation, to make this class culture a bit better, rather than a, you know, strong bullies the weak. The goal is to ensure that the witness should be protected, or the kid who stood up for justice should be protected, while the perpetrator is, educated, able to repent their mistakes and correct themselves. However, as Venerable mentioned in the first question, Rome is not built in one day. You know, the iceberg is not formed within three night. Nothing happens without time. And with these long hours of accumulation of negligence, you can't correct this kind of attitude suddenly. You can't just expect they will become a kind and good people. So being wise is very important in this context. 阿弥陀佛。
当然你可以感觉哈，这个当父母的，这个天下父母心啊，还是会比较担忧孩子啊，在目前的这个社会状况啊， 那我们刚刚谈到安心呢，所以无量寿经当中，释迦牟尼佛还特别要赞叹观世音菩萨，众生若有急难恐怖啊，但知归命观世音菩萨，无不得解脱。所以把观音菩萨的愿力啊要告诉孩子。他往后遇到这种比较危难比较恶劣的行为的时候啊都懂得自诚念观音菩萨。这个感应不思议都能够逢凶化吉这个也很重要。
So being a parent, we will always want to protect our children, to be at peace in this situation, you know, mentally as well. We have Infinite Life Sutra, who taught us that if any beings are in dangers, like life or anything, chant the name of Guan Yin, you know, the name of Guan Yin, the Bodhisattva Guan Yin, and these beings will be able to be relieved from the immediate dangers that face them, that threatens their life or threatens their way of life, threatens them immediately. So chant the name of, teach the children to chant, have the habit of chanting Namo Dabe Guan Xin Busa, Namo Guan Xin Busa, basically just chanting the name of Guan Yin to get out of this trouble. Because the vow of Guan Yin is there, it's not empty words, it has that effect.Helps will arrive in the way. Sifu, 要我继续问吗？
下一个问题了。
好，最后一个了。其实这边，病者在生病的时候，因为身体痛苦，念不进去佛，只有在身体状态好的时候，才能更愿意念佛。怎么办？ED 师姐发问啊，ED Dharma sister ask when someone who is fallen sick because of their you know of their pain because of the pain endured by the body they can't concentrate on Amitofo only when the condition gets better will this person be able to chant Amitofo.So what should we do in face of this situation?
这个佛呢也是告诉我们了，人生有八苦啊，生老病死，怨憎会，爱别离，求不得，五阴炽盛啊，这个病苦的折磨啊，真的是挺难的。所以啊，我们的亲人有这个病苦啊，我们首先要感同身受，就是能理解他的痛苦，这样我们的言语啊，就会让他感觉你很能理解他，这个。病得很苦的人呢，是心灵上是很希望别人能理解到他，体会到他，所以首先这个病苦真的是挺痛苦的，那我们作为家人呢，那我们自己呀、要尽到我们的力。那比方说从身体上可不可以有医学的手段帮助他减轻痛苦那当然中医啊有很多手段甚至于包含呢我们懂一点经络它都有相对应的经脉啊能够多帮他按压缓解 这个痛苦，那这个是我们可以做得到的。哦，那个啊，周医师有讲一个系列的课啊，里面都有教这些穴道的按摩啊。你了解之后可以知道哦，可能你这个亲人他主要的病在哪里啊，然后在这些比较重要的穴道啊，可以多帮他缓解按压啊。当然能够再去做一些针灸啊，好的医生的一些治疗，应该都会有一定的缓解啊。当然在饮食当中呢，就还是要注意了，不要又增加他的病痛啊。所以家人生病啊，对我们来讲也是一个净缘。我们怎么静到我们的心，静到我们的力，那从身体上啊，我们能透过医疗的手段方法帮他减轻痛苦啊，心理上啊，也感同身受，常常给他一些安慰啊。他可能心里会产生一些什么烦躁的念头啊，我们都可以啊用柔软语啊，用一些经教，但是是柔软的啊，让他比较能接受啊。但这些言语他能接受了，可能有一些烦恼，他就比较能够转，能够放得下来。好，而且我们也要不厌其烦的去提醒去劝哦。啊，你不能劝了一次了他有反复，你哎呀我都跟你讲过了你怎么讲不听呢？这个人在很痛的时候啊，他是控制不住的。啊，那变成我们要不厌其烦了。啊，那包含生病了，病得很痛的时候啊，这个我们也要安慰。当然这些话呢讲在前面是更好啊，就是我们过去生都有带业力来啊，纵使我们这一生学佛了，也不代表说我们所有的业果都不现，它有可能是重罪轻报了。一个典型的例子，玄奘大师，这个在佛门的贡献呢，算数一数二的了。对，可是他年老了，也病得很重。他老人家起个念头啊，哎，我是不是啊，经翻错了，才会有这么严重的病？哦，后来菩萨来安慰他，告诉他，你翻的都对。但是因为你过去生当过国王，杀业很重，你说这个都不知道几世前的，所以因果是通三世的啊，所以这是属于重罪轻报，可能这个对病人来讲他比较能释怀，也不容易纠结，更不会产生对因果的怀疑。哦，那假如他病重的时候一怀疑了，那对他就很不利了。哦，这是从心理上安慰啊，理得心安嘛，用义理安慰他啊。好，那第三呢，从灵性方面，因为毕竟是有业力造成的，那这个无微不施啊，得健康长寿嘛。那现在病得很重的人可以多放生。好啊，甚至于家里的人假如看了长辈生病了，他心里难受，你说你吃素啊，对爸爸对妈妈啊， 对这个家人啊有好处，啊，那可能你就借这个缘，可能有一些家人他就发心了，哦，哎，当然就是顺势，不是勉强的，哦，那这些亲人因为他吃素了，这功德啊，对于生病的人，他都是增上缘，他都有功德的。好，那这个放生呢？大智度论有提到，啊，诸功德中啊，放生第一，啊，因为众生最爱惜的是生命，啊，你把他从刀口下救出来了，哇，那这个众生对你的感恩是非常强烈的，啊，那这个。多放生啊，吃素啊，保护生命，这个对亡者会有对于病者有帮助啊，这个功德力呢会比较明显啊，让他痛苦减少啊。我们也有听过一些同修啊，他病得很厉害啊，给他做一次放生啊，哎，他就比较明显。痛苦有减轻的状况，就这个感应啊，还是明显的，可以感受到。哦，因为你病这么重啊，都有一些冤亲债主在干扰，所以我们家里的人呢，能自诚去放生啊，带病者啊，然后呢，还要为病者啊，当然他病者自己也要忏悔。那是最好的，那我们在放生的时候也带病的人做忏悔，跟他这些有缘的众生呢化解，那跟这些有缘众生都结西方缘，我们念无量寿经，念地藏经，劝他们回向这个极乐世界，求生净土啊，冤冤相报，没完没了了。这样解决不了问题了。那佛门常说世事是好事啊，我们也用更积极的态度啊来面对这个情况。其实这个我们在人世间呢，世间人都觉得啊，享福是好事啊。其实享福就是把福报花掉而已了。什么是好事呢？你用非常正确的心态去面对，什么事都是好事。你心用对了，都没有坏事情了。你比方说今天你福报现前了，你把心用对了，你会给众生去想，你不会自己来挥霍掉啊！那好事了。今天面对逆境恶缘，我们知道，这是过去的业，我们逆来顺受，那这个业就消掉了，无债一身轻了。有可能这个病者现在病得很痛苦，这个都在消业了。他假如很正确的心态面对，有可能消消消消到临终的时候，反而障碍小了，都有可能的。这我们都求佛菩萨三宝加持啊。我们看地藏经，婆罗门女，她的母亲造地狱业，哎呀，这个是很不好的事啊。可是呢，婆罗门女她的心很好，她 一片自孝。你看她母亲堕地狱的缘呢，居然让她一心一意把她母亲啊从地狱超拔出来。不只是这样啊，她借由这个缘呢，她更发广大心了，为这些罪苦众生，尤其堕到三恶道、堕到地狱的众生， 他都要去救度他们。你看一个母亲堕落的缘呢，业报现前的缘。所以我们假如善用心，有可能我们家里的人很病得很重啊，可能就变成我们孝心整个把它发出来啊，甚至是慈悲心啊，也这个机借这个机缘发出来啊，更好的效法婆罗门女，一日一夜就念到一心不乱了，好、啊、就念到你一心不乱了，以自己的神通力啊，就去到地狱了。哎，这是地藏经教的了，做不做得到？天下无难事，只怕有心人了。佛事门中有求必应的，都这个很可能，这个真善缘对我们都是很大的帮助。好，阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛，感恩师父。Human has 8 sufferings. So just to remind everyone, the question is when the patients, maybe it's a family member who is a patient and fallen sick because of the sufferings endured by the body, pain endured by the body, they can't concentrate on the name of Amitabha. Only when their condition gets better will they start to chant Amitabha willingly. So how do we solve this problem? How do we, you know, what should we do when this happens? So Venerable answered, human has 8 sufferings. One of them is illness. Helping a patient means we need to be sympathetic first. We need to put ourselves in their shoes as much as we can. Because people who really suffers from illness or any kind of illness really wants people to understand them, care for them. Heart to heart. That's the first kind of first attitude we should have. And if you are the family member of the patient, we should do our best to relieve the sufferings, you know, in three ways. One is physical. Physical ways of relieve their suffering is using the medical means to relieve their pain. In Chinese medicine, it means using acupuncture, acupressure to reduce the pain endured by the body. Dr. Zhou has taught many ways. Last time, I think we all have the lecture by Dr. Zhou talking about the acupoint, acupressure, where you put the pressure in the nerves node so that you can relieve the pain. You can identify where it goes wrong in your body and how we should reduce the pain by applying the acupressure at the right place. So food-wise, we need to be more careful to avoid consuming something that hurt the family member. Say the person who are sick, they can't eat salty, they can't eat oily, we avoid that kind of food. So those are all physical things that we could do for our friends or families who are sick. Mentally, we can console them with kind words and gestures so that they felt listened to and hence open up for advice from you. We need to be patient though when we're advising them, because you will have to repeat a lot of times, more often than not. Remember the first advice, we need to be sympathetic. People who are in pain, they really is in that situation where they can't concentrate, hence they can't listen to us easily. So we need to be patient, repeat the point instructions so that they can, you know, get the point and start working on it, you know, to relieve their sufferings. Because people when in pain, they couldn't control themselves, right? They lost that faculty sometimes. So we need to be very patient. And also, there are past life factors. If we push forward the time or the time into the past, there is always past karma that we bought and came into fruition in this life. And illness is one of the form. So illness is also a result of past karma. For example, Venerable Xuanzang, so Venerable Xuanzang is from Tang Dynasty. He's the one who went to India to retrieve the sutra, all right, from the Nalanda universities and everywhere else. And it's very famous to the West in the form of the Journey to the East. But this is a real life Journey to the East. He's well known top contributor towards the propagation of Buddhism, especially Mahayana Buddhism in China. So his merit must be enormous. You know, he should be very good, having a very good ending. But however, when he, you know, fallen sick in his old age, he suffers immense pain. I think it's headache or something. Immense pain when he, you know, reached old age. And so painful that he, you know, doubted. Like that, no, he doubted, he thought he did something wrong in his translation. He might make a mistake, misinterpret Buddha's sutra into Chinese, from Sanskrit to Chinese. But Bodhisattva came into his dream and affirmed him, you did no wrong in your present life. You did good. However, there is an element of past you have to factor into. You have been a king in one of your lives in the past, and in that life as a king, you hurt, killed, maimed many people. So this headache is a result of you hurting people, killing people in your past life as a king. And understanding how it came to be, you know, because of the past deeds I have committed, helps to relieve the sufferings, helps to understand why am I going through this. It gives a sense of, to be honest, true surrendering, acceptance. I should be going through this. And that actually helps a lot in dealing with the ordeal of sickness, especially terminal sickness. So attitude is very important when we are dealing with illness, sickness. So patience, right, mentally, we need to affirm them. Cause and effect is indeed real, is in effect, hence you are suffering this. And because of the past deeds, maybe you're supposed to have even worse situation happening to you, but because of the merit you have done so far to, you know, towards Buddhism, towards propagating, helping people, you only suffer less than you deserved according to the past. That means you had it easy, and then that will help the person, of course, word it properly, and it will help the person to able to deal with the pain easily or more willing, more open to take it. So worst thing is when they're in pain, they give up chanting Amitabha because they doubt the word of Buddha. And this is where we need to repeat and need to come in and say karma in the past is in effect. We need to remind them, you are just going through this. Once you go through this, your life will be better, or you will be able to go to Pure Land. So we need to be there to help them repetitively, patiently, so that they do not lose faith in the teaching of Buddha, so that they can relieve the sufferings thoroughly. Last one, spiritually. We can encourage or organize vegetarian feast at the event of relatives visiting the patient. Say, because of this patient suffering, you can have vegetarian event, banquet, or some sort of everyone sitting down and not eating meat for one day. Because of this person who is ill, they stop eating meat, hence reducing killing karma. And so it gives merit to the patient, hence relieve their burden, their karmic burden they carry with them, hence relieve their pain and sufferings eventually. So rescuing animal at the verge of being butchered is very good way to elevate their pain, their condition. Encourage vegetarian is one thing, and also function, which is rescuing them from being butchered in their behalf. Because of this illness, you go and do these merits, and hence the patient will receive the benefits of your action as well. So this is another way to relieve their past karma. So there's a way to get them, to help them. And then you encourage these beings to go to Pure Land as well. You know, Nian Fo, Amitofo. Not just release them, but also tell them to Nian Amitofo. So you chant Amitofo to them. Or do the triple gem refuge. So Venerable has emphasized, face the world with a positive attitude. What is a positive mindset, positive attitude? The right mindset, right attitude. First thing is, if we have fortune because of our past karma or what we did, and we just spend it away, it's not necessarily a good thing. What is a good thing is person who has fortune, good fortune in terms of wealth and all that, and they use it and share it with other beings, with everyone, so that everyone can enjoy the fruition of his labor, of her labor. That's putting a right attitude. That's being wise. Negative things like illness, all right, that's not necessarily be an ending, a bad ending, if we have a right mindset, if we have a positive mindset. Because putting a right attitude towards it means that we're able to take it with ease, and we reduce the negative karma. So we're able to, like we talk about, our heart is not at peace. So how do we get at peace? Understand the karma, how it works. Now we're suffering towards it, we are being relieved. For example, the Bodhisattva Dizang or Bodhisattva Siddhigarbha, Dizang, earth treasure, it means. So Bodhisattva Dizang is a very good example. Something that is going wrong, very terrible, but ends up good ending. Mother of Bodhisattva, before he was Bodhisattva, he's a lady, and he's a Brahmin lady. She was called a Brahmin lady. So the past life of Bodhisattva Dizang is a Brahmin lady, Bolomanu. The mother of this Brahmin lady has committed heinous karma and caused her to reborn in hell after she passed away in human realms. She should be suffering a lot more. However, because of the love of this Brahmin lady girl towards her mom, she found... Back then there was Buddha, and she found a Buddha and asked, how do I help her, my mom? My mom is in hell. And the Buddha taught her to chant the name of the Buddha of her time. All right? Also chant the name of Buddha, Nian Fo, but Buddha of her time. And she focused so intense because her love for her mother drives her to do it. I need to get my mother out of the hell. I don't care what happens, I just need to get it. And she concentrated intensely, one day, one night. She attained. Nian Fo, is Nian Fo 3 days. Bolomen Nu is, she one day, one night.
Li Yi Xin Bu Luan.
So, this is Alo Han Guo de Li. Wow, sorry, I was impressed. What? Okay, one day, one night, she attained Arahat ability. Like we all chant Amitofo, but she able to be so intense and concentrate, she able to attain the level of Arahat. Basically, no longer bound by six realms. So, the context is, she able to have the sense of deep meditative power that she can transverse the realm, and she go to the hell realm and help her mom. Because of her merit of being a sage, brings her mom to heaven. So, this supposed to end badly for the mom, which is suffering in hell for a long time, becomes a good thing. Because of mom falling to hell, the daughter really, really, really wanted to help her mom out of it. And she also have a good condition of meeting Buddha, and she earnestly chant the name of Buddha and become a sage herself and helping her mom out of the hell. So yeah, that's it. Let me talk. Thank you. 辛苦了师父这么晚了还有time's up 我觉得时间差不多还有一个问题是家中我们可以留下一次吗郑师兄您觉得呢师父您觉得呢
哦
蟑螂很多为了请走他们而不伤害
好这个 很多事情啊，离不开感应，这个会赶来很多蟑螂、昆虫啊，有可能是我们家里面呢，可能有一些味道啊，或者是什么把它吸引过来了，哦。所以，这个首先是环境，环境很干净的话呢，这蟑螂就不是很喜欢了，对吧？它就不喜欢来了。我们从原因上，为什么会招感这些蟑螂昆虫来？从因上去把它尽力的把它处理好。我是有听说了啊，就比方说这个地很干净的，蟑螂就不是很喜欢来了。那当然师长也有讲过，比方说他刚好遇到这个寝室里有很多蚂蚁啊，这个浴室里面，那我们毕竟呢。这些众生呢，都有灵性的，我们很诚心啊，跟他沟通，是能起到作用的。我记得有一个比较真实的例子，这个爸爸妈妈说要去买杀虫剂了，要来杀这些昆虫。那他们家的孩子很小，也很单纯，他不忍心伤害生命啊。他就把窗户打开啊，然后自己写的字，就是请这些生命啊，赶快出去啊，不然你们会有危险。因为孩子的心很单纯呢，有感动啊，结果这些昆虫就出去了。这进一步是说沟通啊，用诚心去沟通啊，像印光大师。当时候他搬到一个新的地方，里面也有一些昆虫啊，那这些弟子们要去把它清出去呀、印主说不用啊，对，不要伤害到他们啊，他们也是提醒我修行还不好啊，假如我修行好了，他们自己就会搬家了。后来过没有多久啊，这些。蚂蚁啊，都自己搬走了。就大师呢，他可能磁场很好，念佛很精进啊。这些昆虫啊，感应到了，也很尊重大师，他们就自己搬出去了。好，所以以上仅供参考。
I'll do it shortly. So this question I translated in words, and the cost of cockroach to congregate at home, we need to think about it like many ways. First thing is food, right? With food, the creepy-crawlies and the ticks, they all want to eat. So creepy-crawlies and cockroach will usually congregate at places, kitchen floors or something that has dirt or something that has food crumbs and all that. So try to avoid leaving crumbs or leaving it unclean after you have your dinner cooked. Try to clean because Venerable heard that a clean floor just do not will less likely to attract creepy crawlies and cockroach. Another thing is the communications we need to have because there is a case that there's a family where they long story short they chant or trying to communicate with the animals. One of the family members, a kid, and kids are pure at heart. So the kids was like, "Please move house, because we need to be here. Thank you." And they were being very nice and very sincere. And the effect, it took effect. The animals no longer exist, no longer appear in their house. They actually move away from their places. So that's also an element of communication. It has to be done with utmost sincerity. It has to be truly sincere and earnest. the last one is Master Ying Guang's case. He has, Master Ying Guang is a patriarch of Pure Land Buddhism back in the early nationalist China era. So back to the point, Master Ying Guang one day moved to a new place to stay. However, in this new house, new vihara, new house, there's a lot of, you know, insects, in a lot of cockroach insects, etc. And all the lay Buddhists trying to, you know, the Dhamma protector trying to remove these creepycallies, these insects. But Master Ying Guang say, please don't do that, don't harm them. They are here to remind that my cultivation skill has not achieved a certain level. Hence, I need to, you know, they remind me to get good, to improve my cultivation skill. So after a few months of a certain amount of time, the animals, the insects no longer be seen around the house of Master Ying Guang. And Venerable Chanda says that because of the aura of Master Ying Guang, the Sichang, the aura is very good. Every insect very respectful of this Bodhisattva, of Master Ying Guang. Hence, they move away because you don't want to disturb someone you respect. So yeah, but these are all just to be taken as a reference, all right? Not as a ultimate instruction. So take it with a grain of salt. Yeah, Amitofo.
好，谢谢。
The time is up. 感恩陈德法师慈悲在这深夜里或者是很早的为我们开示，为我们解答解惑，在这里我们也带全体的学佛青年团，雪莉净宗学会青年团和。
雪莉净宗学会感恩陈德师父的开示，那我们很开心能见到您，那我就把这个交给郑师兄来了解。参加的不只是青年团的成员，还有全体。我其实今天有三十一位同修参与，青年团的是有十来位，那其他都是我们平常的同修。那我请问师父。 这个课是每个礼拜一次还是一个月一次？因为已经有人问我这个问题了，师父。Uncle
James asking how frequent will we have this session?
我再来安排一下。Whenever
we think about it.
因为已经有人问这个问题，说师傅什么是不是一个礼拜可以一次，还是或者是两个礼拜一次，还有一个月一次，师傅。师傅，你的法缘很好，大家很喜欢。那个我们再商量一下。
好，没问题，师傅，
我们再商量一下。OK，OK。 我刚刚是想到，就是我们可以就一些专题，老和尚的专题的，或者是黄念祖老居士他们讲课的专题，然后可能比方说这些年轻人，他们对这些专题有所深入，这可能对他们建立他们的人生观。 这一生怎么行菩萨道，这会挺有帮助的。举个例子，像黄念祖老居士，有一次是送信佛的青年赴日到日本进修博士学位，他针对这些年轻人做了一个开示。其实这一段不止对年轻人很有帮助。 对任何修行人都很有帮助。那这个我不知道有没有翻成英文了。假如还没翻成英文呢，我觉得很值得翻。我们挑一些专题，翻成英文，那提供给大家可以先看。到时候我们聚会的时候就针对这些内容来探讨。
So Venerable, moving forward, our next sessions, we can be more focused in our topics of our conversation, of our talk. We can excerpt from Master Ching Kong or Master Huang Lianzhu's teachings, talks. For example, there was a recording of Mr. Huang, Master Huang, giving a talk to the youth group or the group of university students that returned from Japan, I think. We can translate that talk, that conversation of him with the students into English, because Venerable is not sure if it's already been translated in English or not. If we can, we can translate to English and we can read through these materials and we can talk about it, what we think about it, or from there, what can we take from it. So that it can be used. 阿弥陀佛。
我们有认识团体，他也有在翻，然后上讲解，把它翻成英文。那可以，我们澳洲，像迪伦啊，他们可以一起参与进来。那我们就可以把这些老和尚的开示啊，或者黄老的，发给大家。我们一起探讨之前就发了，大家听完有什么领悟或者有什么疑问，我们就可以探讨更深入这一篇教诲，或者这一篇教诲听了我们怎么来用啊，怎么来落实啊，这个都可以透过探讨，这样我们每一次的主题啊，内容就可以 focus， 比较集中一些重点。
So 师父就是说那个您有一个已经有一个翻译组织专门翻译老和尚，
对，他们已经翻译一些东西了，我跟他们联系一下，可以挑一些，觉得可能跟我们现在的工作生活啊特别重要的一些开始，那当然除了这些我们事先发给大家的，当然实际上遇到什么还是可以问啊，就是我们一来有。每一次有一些探讨的，大家可以先预习啊，什么问题也可以再问，对。
So Venerable has a group. He has a group that translates Master Ching Kong's and all other masters' talk in terms of Dharma or daily life. So we can, he might contact them to give us a few English translations of the talks, of the topics that are quite suitable to us. And we can read through the material first, let it sink in and think about it. And then maybe next time we have more ideas, more grounds to cover in our topic. We still can ask questions on the spot, but at least this one we have something prepared before we proceed with our session. So, 可以啊，师傅，师兄，郑师兄 ，OK 哦 ，OK。
师傅，如果需要雪梨这边帮忙的话，我可以找人帮忙。有关翻译的部分呢、啊？
这个对承德来讲啊，就是我们。能遇到佛法，这个都是百千万劫难遭遇啊！我们是这样，任何众生都是这样，尤其当人了、啊，人生难得啊！我自己有一次在联合国教科文组织开会，开会之后啊，中午啊用餐，那跟我同桌的啊好几种肤色都有啊，各种的都有，红的、黑的、白的，都跟我同一桌了啊。然后我就请了一个同修来帮我做英文翻译，好，那因为我已经出家了嘛，这么一看就知道是佛教了。然后我就跟他们聊， 聊了没有很长的时间。那比方说我举一个例子哈，我只跟他们说啊，佛开悟说的奇哉奇哉，一切众生皆具如来智慧德相，啊，每一个人都能成佛。他们听到那个英文翻译啊，眼睛瞪得很大，然后他就问了一句话，就重新问一次，你说的是每个人都能成佛？哦，你看他没有机会遇到我，你看你才跟他提这一点，就让他很惊讶啊，每个人都能成佛。他假如我英文好的时候，我就可以继续跟他们介绍佛法了。因为无量寿经说众生善根不可思议嘛，你怎么知道他过去生没有跟佛家的这些缘？他假如有那个因，你这一世又有缘介绍给他，因遇到缘呢，很可能他就会很努力的去学了。我就给大家举一个例子就好了。我认识的一个美国人，他是以色列的后裔啊，以色列人。他什么时候学中文呢？因为他学艺术的，他就看到啊，宋朝有一幅画，就是六祖大师啊劈柴，就一幅画哦，都没有讲话哦，但是看到那一幅画，触动他的善根，过去生的善根，他说我一定要到中国去读书，他就到中国来读艺术系了，他现在已经博士毕业了，然后他的中文呢突飞猛进。我遇到他的时候，他好像才学了2年左右，然后我就请教他，你为什么中文学这么好？他说啊，首先呢，一分沉静得一分利益，他讲出这个话的时候，我都快晕过去了啊！他赢了印光祖师这些法语啊，他讲得很流利啊，你要专注去学，这个人叫 Michael， 现在已经在北京大学工作了。所以众生善根不可思议啊！你看他只看了一幅画了，就触动他的善根了。所以那一幅画放光了，那一幅画有佛光。哦，真的，你不能去忽略任何一个你生命中有缘的众生啊。有可能他过去生，虽然他现在，可能中文不懂，或者可能他还没有遇佛法，但不代表他没有这个善根。有可能我们就是他的真上缘，所以诸位仁者啊，你们都是可以讲英文的啊，我这一辈子再来学太晚了。你们更有机缘呢，可以去度这些众生，哪怕是度了一个两个，都功德无量啊，是吧？他肯念佛求生净土，他可能就成佛了，那你也是功德无量了啊！大慈菩萨说，你能劝两个人念佛，两个人求生净土啊，哇，那就跟你往生差不多了。你能劝更多的人，那你就是菩萨了。好，阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛。So venerable is being a very fortunate. Felt very fortunate to be able to hear Buddhism, so directly. Because being able to hear Buddha Dharma is a very fortunate event, very rare and fortunate event. We would not know it until we lost it.So Venerable has this experience in UNESCO. And in UNESCO, he has met people of all race and all backgrounds, all types of skin colors, and everyone sit together in one tables. And because Venerable's appearance as a monk is blatantly obvious, it's very obvious that he's a Buddhist monk. because of his appearance as a monk. So he, of course, will talk about Buddhism. He has a translator next to him and translate his words. He didn't talk much. He only gave one word of Buddha's speech when he enlightened and say, oh, all beings, all sentient beings have the as the Buddha's wisdom, has the Buddha's virtues, has Buddha's merits. They originally have it. So everyone can be a Buddha. Everyone. So everyone at the table who never heard of this stare at him white and blank, like, what? And asking Venerable to repeat again that word. Please repeat again what you mean, everyone? Everyone can be a Buddha. So they were so surprised. I mean, we heard of this so many times, right? Because we have this fortune to meet them, but they never heard of it in their life. And Buddha is someone who's very amazing. And to be able to say this sentence, everyone can be a Buddha, is a shocking revelation to them. And so this emphasized the point that, in the Infinite Life Sutra, there is a saying, there is a word saying that the 众生三根不可思议, the good root of all sentient beings is unbelievable. Like when the good root meets the right condition, it will sprout very quickly into a fruit, into a tree. We just need to pour that water to them, the yuan, the water. Another example to push this home, this point home, is there's an American with the name Michael. He's a descendant of Israeli Jew, Venerable knew Michael. One day he walked by a drawing of Master Huineng, which is the patriarch of the Zen Buddhism, the Chinese Chan Buddhism, and the one that propagates Chan, the Zen. And he saw Master Huineng chopping the wood, and no one say anything to him. He just looked at the drawing, he's chopping the wood, and something in him was ignited. He's touched. And immediately he flew to China and learned the drawings, the art, the Chinese art of drawing. And now he worked in Beijing University. When Venerable visited him, he's already been learning Chinese for 2 years. But Venerable almost fainted when Venerable asked Michael, hey Michael, how do you learn Chinese so quickly within 2 years? Because he can converse very good, very well. And this this gentleman, this Michael, Mr. Michael, replies, with 1 ounce of respect and sincerity, you get 1 ounce of benefits. It's basically word for word from Master Ying Guang's. This is something that a person needs to be really deep in Chinese to get it and to be able to use it. And so to do that of just being exposed to 2 years of learning Chinese, it's just amazing. So Venerable Chen Te almost fainted after hearing this. So do not underestimate the capacity of all sentient beings in their ability to comprehend and practice Buddhism. And remember, everyone has the root, has the potential, has the cause to be a Buddha, but they just need the right condition. And because Venerable felt like he's unable to immediately speak English in this life, so he's encouraging everyone who can speak English to make use of this skill, to make use of this condition that you are born into, to bring more people who had never heard of this Dharma into this wondrous way of life. And in Buddhism, in Pure Land especially, Master Ying Guang mentioned, if you can advise and able to successfully advise one person to be born in Pure Land, you're amazing. If you can advise two person, all right, to actually born in Pure Land, that means through you, through your conditioned, they actually sprouted and actually born in Pure Land. Chan Amitofo, go to Pure Land. If you can do two, right, you're basically Bodhisattva. Yeah, basically Pusa, basically Bodhisattva. So yeah, so encourage everyone to, you know, make use of this gift. Oh, thank you, 阿弥陀佛。好，感恩师父。
有这份心啊，把身体借给佛菩萨用，佛菩萨就会加持，就会透过你去宣扬佛法。
If we have the right intention, we can you know, borrow our body to Bodhisattva so that they can use our faculty to propagate Dharma. If you have that intention and have that vow, you can do that.
好，
感恩师父。
你们那边太晚了啊，大家早点休息啊。哎，夜梦弥陀。
夜梦弥陀。It's very late for us now. Venerable would like to wish us a good night. So a good night dreaming about 阿弥陀佛。So good night, everyone. 感恩师父。
感恩师父。
Good night, everyone. Have a good dream.
谢谢
阿弥陀佛。
阿弥陀佛。
太温柔，
感恩。
希望我们很快就可以再跟师父见面哈。
Uncle James say, "Well, may we meet Venerable as soon as possible."
好，大家再见哈，晚安，晚安。
谢谢师父，
再见，再见，
阿弥陀佛，
再见，
再见，阿弥陀佛，
再见，
阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛。
谢谢 Dylan。
Thank you, thank you.谢谢大家，晚安，阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛，阿弥陀佛。
我先澄清哦，我是有想到 shopping， 还有去旅游更多了，所以我没有那么神圣了哈、哦，所以不要把我抬得太高，阿弥陀佛。